know what you're thinking. You're thinking, wow, that outfit looks really familiar. And you know why? Because it is. I realized, man, I've got a ton of books to review, so I'm just going to sit down and do it. So this is the very beginning of a marathon review session. Good for you, I hope. It will be kind of painful for me because as much as I love talking, I'm glad I have a massive cup of water. Yowza, like, it's hard, like, physically to talk. Anyways, so this book that we are going over is, I feel like it's a special treat because I'm sure most of you, if not any of you, will have heard of it. It is called Saving Wishes by G.J. Walker Smith, and I discovered this on iBooks 5-ish years ago. It was one of those at the bottom of the screen where it's like, it's free. Because you know how a lot of authors will give you the first book for free and then you have to buy the rest of the series? Well, she sucked me in with that. Her and C.J. Duggan, who I will be doing next. Yeah, I discovered them at the same time, probably because they're both Australian and because these are both YA. And so, yeah, they got lumped together as something that I should check out, and I checked them out, and I got sucked in. It's also not my typical read. It's a romance, and I'm not a super sappy person. I was just gonna say my mother and sister, but my dad, maybe even my brother and my other sister, they might all love, like, the Hallmark movies. They make me want to vomit. But, you know, sometimes you do want a nice little love story, a little pick-me-up. So if you're a dude, this is not a review for you because you're just not gonna care. Or if you're a girl who's you're like, I don't really do love stories either, you know, you can skip. It won't hurt my feelings. Saving Wishes is the first in, let's see, one, two, three, four. The two small ones don't really count because they're not about her, but we'll count them just because. So, it's what, four, five, six, I think seven is the final number. And there are two prequel books, so technically nine. Oh no, that's five. I can't count. I don't do math, right? Not even basic counting. So that's two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight. Plus the two prequels, so that's 10. So basically a 10 series I love because I have fallen in love with all these characters, so the more the better, you know what I'm saying? First one, as I said, is YA. However, they do venture more into the NA, the new adult realm, basically starting with the second novel. I mean, this one does have some more mature elements to it. And as far as I can remember, none of the books are actually explicit. However, they kind of age out of YA, and it does, there are some sexual themes to it. Just so you know, like, moving forward depends on who your reader, if you're reading with your kid or, you know, your teenage daughter or whatnot, like, you might want to vet it. Whoa, it's late. On to the book, because that's really what you care about. The main character is a young girl named Charlotte Blake. She is 17, most lovingly referred to as Charlie, and she is a troublemaker. And that is what I love so much about her. Do not let the girl on the cover fool you. Charlie is a little hellion, and she's hilarious. Like, I think that is what is so charming and endearing about her, because not only does she basically live in the land of fairy, but she lives by her own rules. Like, she loves to dish it out. Part of my problem with her is she does not necessarily always know how to take it, and that feels like me. I would rather dish it than receive it, but I feel like if you're gonna dish it, you better learn how to receive it, especially if that's how you're presented in a book. So I do not always understand why she runs and hides from consequences, or she feels remorse. I know that sounds terrible that like someone can do something mean and then not feel remorse for it, but she just has the personality of someone who will defend herself, who will say, yeah, I did that. You deserved it. But sometimes she's just like, oh, you know, so-and-so, please protect me, or, you know, anyways. Love her. I think she's a ham. But so it starts with her having a near-death encounter with a car, and the driver of this car is an extremely attractive American boy named Adam Decarie. Decarie. It sounds so much better in my head. I'm sorry, I never took French. I am not French, so I'm trying. But she meets Adam, and they embark on a romance. She has been raised by a single parent, which is actually her brother, named Alex. And she has, not run-ins with the law, but, you know, she's just somebody, as I said, she's a little bit of a hellion, but she butts heads with her French teacher, Gabrielle Decarie, who, if you can put two and two together, is related to Adam. So that is why he is in Piper's Cove, which is where Charli lives, and it is in Australia. So he has come to Piper's Cove on a whim, and he is staying with his cousin, who Charli refers to as the Parisian witch. I mean, she's just really funny. She's super clever. And then she has run-ins with this group of girls she calls the Beautifuls, who, you know, this is apparently a really small town, and so I guess these three girls kind of have the run of it, and they think they're super important, but they're really not in the grand scheme of things. They don't see eye to eye with Charli, because Charli is a unique personality. It's really not, like, detail-heavy. It's really about Adam and Charli meeting and forming a romance and falling in love, with a couple other things tossed in. The biggest of which, or it's just two big things. So, spoiler alert, if you don't want a spoiler, change the channel, walk out of the room, forget you ever saw this. So the first one is we find out that Alex is not her brother, it is actually her father. So for me, I was surprised by this, only because I did not see that plot line coming. My mother is 12 years older than her brother, so the fact that they are 17 years apart did not necessarily ring any alarms for me. Hello, has anybody seen or heard of the Duggars? Like, I know they have a million children in between, but people have oops babies all the time. So yeah, so there was a large age gap, and, you know, I did find that kind of funny, but as I said, there's a large age gap between my mom and her brother. I just never saw that as being an important plot point. So I was like, what? I still loved it because I loved that even though he was pretending to be her brother, he was her father. Like, he raised her, so he did still get to play that role, and he was a really great dad. Obviously, he was 17 when he had her, and so he had kind of a youthful mentality when it came to fatherhood, and that's probably why she is such a hellion, guys. That's probably why she is such a hellion, because he kind of stoked the flames. He encouraged her imagination and her belief in kind of magic, things like fairies and wishes on things like eyelashes and ladybugs and whatnot. I really loved their dynamic, and I thought it was a fantastic surprise to learn it was her dad. A small surprise is when we learn that he and Gabby have been in a relationship for a while, because as I said, it's a small town. Sometimes you just don't want small town gossip to know your business, so they've been hiding it for a while, but that was a small surprise. The other big one is Charli has a best friend named Nicole, and for some time, for years in fact, they have been planning and saving for their post-high school adventures. However, when Adam comes in the picture, as any red-blooded girl will do, she will kick her friends to the curb, and she essentially spends all of her time with Adam. And this is another thing that does bother me. I mean, I know it's not a book about friendship. It is a book about their relationship, but I feel like there was a big jump from the Nicole we met at the beginning to the Nicole that she ends up being. And so I do wish that we'd had some more of her in between. I don't know how Walker could have done it, because I thought the writing was pretty tight. But I do feel like Nicole needed more development. What happens, because of Charli, Nicole gets involved with another boy who is not nearly as morally upstanding as Adam is. And this is all fuzzy, because you don't know how much is Nicole and how much is Ethan. But what happens is Adam and Charli break up, because Charli realizes Adam belongs in New York. He's incredibly wealthy. He's had this vastly different upbringing and lifestyle. And so she's just like, I don't see how it can work. So she breaks his heart and sends him packing, but not before he gifts her the money that he earned from restoring an old boat. But Nicole, she steals the money, and then she and Ethan get out of Dodge. And so that was kind of Alex and Nicole's betrayal, kind of the two big plot twists or points outside of just the romance. So back to Nicole stealing the money and, you know, just going that way. So, like, you see, you can see a shift in her. You know, she starts hanging out with the beautifuls, who are their arch enemies. She starts acting distant. She's not as reliable. But I felt like it was a huge jump from neglected best friend who's dating a boy. So, a little bit of caveat. This is a boy who she had known for a while, and he had been out of town, and then he had recently come back to town. And, he was always someone that everybody knew. Nicole didn't really like. He's just someone she wasted time with. So it's just a huge jump from her being the loyal best friend to somebody who would then commit such a huge betrayal with somebody who she's not even that serious about. And, you know, like, what drives a person without a massive fight or misdeed on one party's side to drive the other party to do something so terrible, you know? So, like, I loved the betrayal, because we needed something like that. We needed some excitement, some major, oh my gosh, you know? But I felt like with Charli, and I didn't always understand her motives. Like, I felt like she was represented one way, but then she would behave another way. So I feel kind of like that with Nicole, where we don't fully understand who she is. So understanding her actions is difficult. It just didn't necessarily feel organic. And for me, that's a huge thing, especially because this book, I mean, I just think it's marvelous. The characters all feel so legit, and the situations feel completely plausible. But then, yeah, you pull out things and I'm like, that's kind of contrary to everything you've represented, like the entire way you wrote the book. And then you have your characters do something I just wouldn't think would be within the realm of possibility. But as I was saying, I love the characters. I love Adam. You know, Charli calls him a gorgeous French-American boy. Alex calls him a boy wonder. And I'm just like, I'm in love with him. He's not real, but I'm in love with him. I want to date him. Obviously, he's not real, and he's already committed to somebody else. But that's what you want from your characters. You want your readers to wish they were real. One of my favorite parts about this, which it's very funny, because I always thought of myself as something of a realist, but kind of the more I look at my reading choices or things that draw my attention, I find I do like fantasy. And so one of my favorite aspects of the entire series, but obviously this one, because this is what we're talking about, is Walker's ability to create magic to weave in fairies, not fairy tales, but fairies. And I've been meaning to do this, but I haven't looked into these or, you know, Googled these fairies to see if they're legit or if she just came up with them on the top of her head. But it's incredible how she weaves in just the smallest fairy details, which I know sounds super cheesy and you're like, wow, you're going on about fairies, like how old are you? But she uses them to emphasize her point. Like, gosh, of course I can't remember any that are specific to this book. I will when it no longer matters. But so it's like in the next book, she's talking about diamonds because Charli, you know, she's an individual and Adam, spoiler, which, yeah, it's not much of a spoiler because this really happens pretty soon in the novel, but Charli and Adam get married in the next book. So he's looking for rings for her, but he knows he can't just get her anything. And she's kind of like, well, let me tell you the story about these fairies and where diamonds really come from. Or is it in the next book or is it in the third book? Anyways, talking about the man in the moon. And Charlie's like, well, of course there's no man in the moon because there's a fairy named Clotilde in the moon. And you can make wishes to her and she can send down keys to open doors for those wishes. And of course, then Adam says, well, have you wished to her? He's like, no, because I'm afraid of what door that key will open. Because basically, if it doesn't open to you, I don't want that. So it's not silly little child things, but it's incredibly sweet and poignant. Poignant's a better word than sweet, but they're just really beautiful, poignant moments when she brings in all this fairy stuff. And I'm like, where does Walker come up with it? Like, was that an obsession of hers before she wrote the books and she just decided, hey, you know what, I'm going to integrate more than one of my interests into one place. Oh man, you know, like sometimes when you just really get on a roll about something and then you're done talking about it, it's like that's the only thing you could think about and now you can't think about anything else. I'm trying to think of other things to talk about in the book. I will say, as much as I love Charli and Adam's romance, I did sometimes struggle with Charlie's frame of mind, her outlook on things. I don't struggle with it as much in this novel as the next one in Second Hearts, because this one, it's just dreamy and magical and I'm willing to accept everything that happens. But her willingness to just kind of go with the flow and how Adam is the one for her from first sight, or like it doesn't really matter what happens because, you know, that was the love that they were supposed to have at that time. I guess I'm more concrete. I'm more of a realist. I don't really believe in chance. I believe in not predestination, but I do believe there is a reason for everything and it is not luck. It is not chance. But as I said, this book is very, I'm trying to find a new word. It's just not really, she is an individual not steeped in reality all the way. You know, she just has this frame of mind where she believes in magic and everything kind of falls in line with that. And so I'm willing to accept it. All of that said, obviously, I think that Walker did an amazing job at world building and her basic plot. Love it. There are a couple of character issues that I have. But it's just, it's a sweet little book. I feel like when you say a sweet little book, it lessens the novel. And this really is not a novel that needs to be underestimated. But it's just, yeah, it's one of those things where if you need to pick me up, pick it up. I've picked it up half a dozen times, if not more. If I really had an issue with this outside of the characterization problems, it's that It's the mechanics, it's the sentence structure, it's the way that Walker writes. Like, sometimes you do need those punchy little sentences. And on the whole, they work. But we need sentence variation, and there's a lot of times when it's just incomplete sentence, starting with and or but. I need a little bit more variation and a little less like bam, 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 bam. You know, like you could have put a comma in there and the sentence would have been much better. You know, I'm willing to overlook it because it's a great story and I think you should pick it up. It could possibly still be free. I don't know because obviously I bought it, so it doesn't tell me. As I said, there are a number of sequels. Obviously, there's the next one where she and Adam get married, and unlike the summer series by C.J. Duggan, where it focuses on, like, you have your first book, and then all the subsequent books focus on those tertiary characters. This follows Adam and Charli the entire time, except for the two little books, Silver Dawn and Sand Jewels. Those branch off into two other characters, but obviously they're more like novellas than actual novels. So all of you romance lovers, check it out. Let me know what you think. Do you love Charli as much as I do? Do you question her animosity with the beautifuls the way I do? Do you love how naughty she can be? So yes, Saving Wishes, fantastic book. And I'll be seeing you in the same outfit for my next video. So stay tuned. Bye.